Peaceburgh, and I have been reading some books by Charles Eisenstein for the past year or so, and I've been very personally inspired by his work, so I'm very excited to have him here today. And he's written several books. The first is The Yoga of Eating, which is all about diet, which I found very fascinating. His most famous work is The Ascent of Humanity, which when I read that, it basically summarized the previous 20 books that I had read. It brought them all together into a very comprehensive work, which was just so profound. And his most recent book, Sacred Economics, which I'm only on about the third chapter because it was just released, is also very inspiring. And Sacred Economics takes a completely new look at economics. And part of the Sacred Economics is the concept of a gift economy. And in here in Peaceburgh, we've been experimenting with a gift economy purely because of an essay that Charles wrote through his blog on realitysandwich.com. The essay is called A Circle of Gifts. And in this essay, it describes a thing called a gift circle. And many of the people here I actually met through a gift circle, because after reading the essay, we started having these gift circles here, and we've had about 8 or 9 of them. And it's a way of connecting people's needs and people's gifts, which is really what an economy is set to do. And so Charles today will be speaking about sacred economics, as well as many other things, I presume. So on behalf of Transition Pittsburgh, which is the group which we've been doing the gift circles through, Transition Pittsburgh is part of the Transition Town Movement, which is a global movement, and another focused on community resilience. Another group sponsoring this event is Evolver Pittsburgh, which is related to the website Reality Sandwich, which he's a writer for, and that's a global social movement. And the third sponsor of this event is sust-enable, the Metametry, which is a documentary that many of these folks are working on, which asks the question, what is sustainability? And so without further ado, I'd like to give a round of applause for Charles Eisenstein and welcome.
Thanks, Kevin. And thank you all for your patience. Maybe you weren't patient, maybe you were stewing in frustration. That's what I always think when I'm on hold, you know, and they finally say thank you for your patience. I'm like, how do you know I was patient? But we had technical difficulties, they had to set up a teleprompter, so I have to say. Yeah, so I'm Charles, and now, I don't want to like mess with the videotaping too much, but here I am stuck behind this podium. And I'm just thinking, like, what is it about a podium that I don't like? Well, for one thing, like, I could have my secret notes here, right? So then I could be speaking what is prepared in advance and not actually being in relationship to the audience. The other thing, though, is it hides most of me and only shows the head, which in our culture is somehow considered the most important part. That's where change is supposed to come from. We're supposed to have an idea and then convince other people of that idea, and through the power of intellect and reason, change the world. That idea is hundreds of years old. It definitely goes back to Descartes. He said that the way to change things is you go into a dark room in isolation from everything else, and you enter the realm of pure meditation, and you come out with the idea, and there it is. And on a social level, on a collective level, we're doing that too. We kind of send the scientists, or send the technocrats in, and they come up with the answers, and we're all waiting for the experts to do it. And so this podium kind of taps into that, you know, so it kind of makes me into this head, this expert, who is going to broadcast the answer out to you guys. But I think we all recognize that paradigm is becoming obsolete. Therefore, I would like to liberate myself from the podium.
So,
I can liberate the mic from the podium too. Get that. All right. So, hopefully, the video people can handle it. All right. Good. Now I'm more exposed here. Maybe I'll talk a little bit about the title of the book, Sacred Economics. Because if anything isn't sacred, it's probably economics, which, well, it depends what you think economics is, but when economists talk about economics, they're really talking about money. And money is self-evidently the opposite of the sacred in our world, in the world we live in. Even though, as Kevin was saying, really the purpose of money is to connect gifts and needs. It's to facilitate the flow of gifts. At its core, it's a really beautiful thing. You know, it's like, here I have something, I'd like to give it to you. And you feel gratitude, you'd love to give something to me, but I just don't have anything that I need right now. So we have this wonderful thing called money. You can give me this worthless thing instead, this shiny piece of useless metal, or this cowrie necklace, this string of wampum, this useless thing. Give that to me, and it says, you know, I really want to give you something, but I can't. Here's a token of my gratitude. That's what money is supposed to be. Did I do historical research and find out that that's what money once was? No, not really. Although that thread has always existed, that spirit has always inhabited money. It's coexisted with another spirit for a very long time. But we can kind of recognize it, you know? When I say that, maybe I'm imagining things, but it strikes a chord of like, yeah, that's what it's supposed to be. Money's supposed to be a token of gratitude. And it's supposed to connect gifts and needs and make us all richer. It's supposed to enable us, to encourage us to give our gifts and to show gratitude. And the reason, and that sounds pretty sacred to me, but the reason I say that if anything is sacred, if anything is not sacred today, it's money, is that we're living in a world now where it seems very much that money is having the opposite effect. It's not helping us circulate our gifts and express our gifts. It's actually stopping us from doing that. Maybe many of you have experienced this in your lives, especially if you're an artist or a musician or pretty much anyone. The thing that you really want to do that's coming from your heart, that's the most generous, beautiful thing to do, that's not usually where the money is. Money is in something that you don't really want to do that much. Maybe it's something that's downright odious, something that is repugnant. Or maybe the money is in something that, well, I guess it's okay. I mean, I suppose that job is at least somewhat challenging and it's not objectionable. And, you know, I'm doing it for the money. It's practical. I should be thankful. It's a better job than most people have. But that's where the money is. So, for example, if you want to go out there and restore ecosystems, say you find some barrels of leaking toxic waste somewhere, and you take it upon yourself to organize lots of people to go clean up that toxic waste. Are you going to get rich that way? Or are you going to get rich, say, being a lobbyist for chemical companies to pass laws to enable more toxic waste to get thrown into the environment? That's where the money is. Why? Why should it be that way? Money, on a collective level, it's supposed to say to individuals and to corporations or to anybody, it's supposed to say, here's what our society wants right now. Here's what we value. But today, that incentive, that signal of what our society values is it's going toward things that rip apart society and are destroying the planet. And so why should that be? And that's just the beginning of the problem for the non-sacredness of money. But so in writing this book, I kind of touched on that original true essence of money and what it's supposed to be. And I thought, now it's an opportune moment, because the money system, as we know, is falling apart. And that's good, because that gives us the opportunity to create something new. Or perhaps, instead of saying it's falling apart, we can say that it's going through a transition. It's metamorphosizing into something new. So, really, what my work is about is making money sacred again. Money has a magical power. It's insubstantial. It's only little pieces of paper, bits of computers, which is, you know, it's quite ironic. Today we have this debt ceiling crisis, you know, and all this talk about the budget deficit and the national debt, and therefore we can't afford to do the things that we can once do. People say, well, yeah, we can't afford to have, well, here we are, okay. Higher education used to be basically free a generation ago in the 60s. Public universities were, they cost almost nothing. Well, since then, the cost of a university education has gone up way faster than inflation, way faster than anything else except for medical care. So we can't afford that anymore. We can't afford to pay for everybody's medical care. We can't afford to build a big system of rail like we could afford 50 years ago to build an interstate highway system. Well, what is this can't afford? What does that really mean? It means that certain bits in computers are in the wrong configuration. It means it's this can't afford exists purely on a symbolic level. On a material level, we have all of the skills and materials and technologies necessary to do all of these things. There's nothing that we had in the 50s or 60s that we don't have today that would allow us to build whatever we want on this planet, to create a society that we want. It's not a lack of material, it's not a lack of skill. What is lacking? It's this magical thing, it's this symbol, it's nothing that has such power that paralyzes us. So you can say that money is losing its magic power. Money, as we've known, is losing its magic power. It's not only the common people that experience that, even the elites now. The elites are feeling like things are getting out of control. Ben Bernanke or whoever, they go up there and they deliver their ritual incantations, and the economy doesn't respond the way that they want it to. And you can see the breakdown of our system of magic in the impasse that's going on in Congress today. They're wielding these words, but they don't believe them anymore. We don't believe them anymore. And the system is heading towards gridlock. So this is just one of the signs of breakdown that we're experiencing. So what I did with this book then is in the first third of the book, I investigate how we got where we are today, how money has come to encourage the very opposite of what we want to create, of the manifestation of our gifts. Why it is that you can make money dumping toxic waste without cleaning it up. Why should that be? What is it about money that causes that? And in the second third of the book, I then describe what a money system would look like that did the opposite. personal level. Because, in other words, how to live in alignment with this new system of money, which isn't just a vision, it's actually something that's coming. It's a transition that's already underway. And we can see signs of it in certain trends in the economy. For example, the trend toward gift economics that Kevin was talking about. It's not just idealistic young people coming together. The internet is very much a gift economy. And we're entering an age where many goods are becoming zero cost. So, for example, digital content. And in the book, I talk a lot more about this transition and how it's happening. But I think ultimately the transition has to happen on a personal level too. A new money system corresponds to a very different way of thinking and being, a different state of consciousness. Because money is so wedded to our consciousness, our way of relating. Money is the embodiment of the spirit of our civilization. Any phenomenon that you investigate today, and you ask, why is this happening the way it's happening? You ask a few whys, and you get to money. Money is, if you ask, why is cannabis illegal? You go, you ask a few levels, okay, the hemp industry, paper industry, oh, someone's making money off of it. You ask, why, any issue that you're interested in, the prison system or the music industry, why are we doing it this way? You get to the money. So money is at the heart of our way of life. And as I'll explain, it actually embodies the defining myths of our civilization, which I call the story of the people. So part of what I write about and what I speak about is this personal shift into alignment with sacred economy. And something that we can start doing right now. I always find, you know, when I listen to a speaker and they talk about the solutions part, right? First they talk about the problems part, and that can be really dispiriting, you know, things are terrible. Okay, I get it, I heard that before. Now how about the solutions? And the solution is supposed to be empowering. We must reduce carbon emissions by 90% in 20 years. We must do this, this, this. We must develop alternative energy sources. But to me, that's actually dispiriting too. Because quite evidently, we're not doing any of those things. These problems have been known for 30, 40 years in the environmental sphere. We've known about the dangers of greenhouse gases. But in the last 30 years, greenhouse gas emissions have like doubled. You know, I remember when I was a teenager reading these alarmist reports about the disappearing rainforests and these maps of what it looks like, you know, 1900, what it looks like now, projections for 2000, et cetera, et cetera. Like, we understood, and it kept progressing anyway. And so when I hear we should do this, we should do that, I think, well, who's we? And am I powerful to make this happen in a way beyond, you know, then here's what you can do. And then say, well, you can change your light bulbs into CFCs, or you can, you know, recycle your whiskey bottles, or something like that. Or if you take it to an extreme, what you can do is you can go into the woods and not consume anything anymore and live off roots and berries. You can conserve, and on some level that's disempowering too, because where do you do that how are you helping the world transition by doing that? And then there's the whole matter of Yale's paradox, which maybe a few of you know about, which basically says conservation doesn't work because you're just going to make those resources cheaper for somebody else, and they're going to use even more of them. So we understand that a deeper shift is necessary. That includes everything. Because money is located in everything. It's tied to everything. So, let me experiment that either at the base level, the government issues a bond and the Federal Reserve indirectly buys that bond and just creates that money out of nowhere. Every time that happens, more money is owed than was actually created because there's interest on that debt. That's when they say the government's creating money, it's actually the Federal Reserve. The government's just issuing debt. And so the government's gonna have to pay back even more debt. Now, where's this extra money gonna come from? And this is on the consumer level too, or on the business level. Money is created when a bank issues a loan. I'll loan you $1 million. And let's see, how about you're a creditworthy borrower, so 7% interest, 10 years to pay back $2 million. That's how much $1 million is after 10 years at 7% interest. Okay, so I'll lend you $1 million, you're going to pay back $2 million. It's not just some money that's created like this, all money is. So I'm going to lend everybody in this room $1 million, okay? And in 10 years, everybody in this room has to pay me back $2 million. Well, where's that extra, how many people were here? 80 people. Where's that extra $80 million going to come from? How are you going to get $2 million? Well, one way you can do it is to take it from him, right? So an interest-based money system induces competition. There's never enough. Or you go bankrupt. Either you get it from somebody else or you go bankrupt. Now that's an oversimplification, because in the real economy, how does that money get paid back? Well, by the time 10 years rolls around, I will have lent you even more money. I lend even more money to pay the interest on the existing money. And who do I lend money to? Not just everyone. I only lend money to you if I think you're going to pay it back. If I think you're going to create goods and services and sell them, or you're going to get a job working for somebody who's going to create goods and services and sell them. So we just slow down a bit, because I don't want people to get lost. It's actually very simple. It's, I will give you money if you will earn even more of it. Either you're an entrepreneur, you have a great business idea. You say, Charles, I'm going to see that forest out there, I'm going to cut that down. I'm going to build houses. And with your $1 million, I'm going to make $5 million. I'm going to pay you back $2 million in interest. And I'm going to make $3 million, I'm getting rich. And I'll be like, you're a fine young man, Kevin. That's a good business idea. Here's your loan. Now, maybe not all of you are as entrepreneurial as him. Maybe you'll just go to work for him, you know, paying his salary. That's where the money's coming from. Now, if someone comes to me with a business idea, I'd like that $1 million to clean up that toxic waste dump. And I guess I will pay back. But it's really important. Like, sorry, I would like to clean it up too, but you know, my bank owes money too. I have my bondholders, I have my shareholders. And if I lend money like that, I'm going to go out of business. I'm sorry, I can't do it. So money is going to the people who will create goods and services. But there's never quite enough of them. So what I've basically just explained is how interest, money that's created as interest-bearing debt, causes competition. It also causes and necessitates growth, economic growth. How are you gonna get, who's gonna get the money? It's the person who's gonna create new goods and services. It's the person who's gonna take that forest and cut it down and make lumber and sell it as a commodity. That's the conversion of nature into goods. That's one way. The second way is to take relationships and convert them into services. So here's Kevin again, who comes with another business idea. Says, you know, there's this community out there, and they don't have childcare, they don't have daycare. Instead, they have this cooperative system where they take care of each other's kids, they don't pay for it. I'm going to go in there and open a daycare center. And for that to work, I'm going to, with advertising, I'm going to convince them that really only educated experts should be allowed to take care of children. Maybe I'll even pass some legislation to make it illegal to educate your own children. And it'll become a paid service. And so, yeah, that's great. There's a business plan for you. But if you have the opposite plan, if you're going to say, you know, I'm going to teach people to take care of their kids, or empower them to do that, or empower them to share and to cooperate and not buy stuff, then you're not creating goods and services. Actually, you're destroying goods and services. Anytime you do something like that, like the gift circle, get or a time bank, you know, you get people together to exchange things without money, you are actually hurting GDP. You are reducing the size of the economy. It's economic degrowth. Anytime you do something for yourself, you gain a skill, you teach a skill that allows someone to do something without money, you are slowing down the economy, which is the opposite of what the politicians want us to do. Or, I mean, whatever, from Barack Obama to Eric Cantor, I mean, everybody in between, left, right, center, they all believe that the solution to our economic problems is to reignite economic growth, get the economy growing again, which means converting more of nature into goods, more of relationships into services. So another example, when I was a kid, we rarely eat at a restaurant. Like once a month, maybe twice a month. Mostly, Mom went to the store, she bought raw ingredients, and she cooked dinner. And so this service of cooking, of food preparation, was not, by and large, was not in the money economy. Most people did it themselves, for their families, and that's called a gift. If you do it without money, it's a gift, okay? So it's a gift relationship. Today, something close to two-thirds of all meals are prepared outside of the home. Even if you go to the supermarket, you get the takeout from the deli. People don't make stuff with raw ingredients very much anymore. So now that's become a service. That conversion has caused the economy to grow a lot. That's been a major growth industry, as has childcare. And if you want to get rich, all you have to do is find something that people still do for themselves and turn it into a service. Like, for example, mentorship. You know, for tens of thousands of years, tribal elders have been mentoring us, or village elders. We learn, we get wise advice and encouragement from our elders. Now, you can pay a life coach to do that, or a psychologist or something like that. So there's an example of something. Medicine in general was once not a paid service. It was, if you got sick, you would go to, you know, every other grandmother knew convert into board feet, and as long as there's still some gift relationships left to convert into professional services. But what happens when we run out? What happens when you can't increase the fish catch anymore because the fish hole is extinct? And you can't cut down more forests and drill more oil because the oil is all gone or dwindling. And when gift relationships are almost all gone, which is a point that we're reaching, which is why we have no community. This community is a web of gifts. That's what community is. And that's why if you try to get together with people in your neighborhood and create community by having a potluck, and well, what are we going to do together? Like, you have to actually create something together to have community. You have to depend on each other. Otherwise, you know, you get these online little communities where you get them weak, and or you get these flame wars. It doesn't matter. You don't depend on each other, you don't need each other. You can't have community if everyone has a secret knowledge of I don't need you. I can just pay for it. Whatever I need, I can pay for it. So this yearning for community is a symptom of the exhaustion of gift relationships that can be converted into money. So basically what's happening today is that there is no more room for growth. The ecosystem cannot sustain it anymore. We've exhausted almost all of the potential for growth. We could maybe grow a little bit more if we exploit the last refuges, like the Alaska Wildlife Refuge. We can, you know, pump a little bit more oil. We can squeeze this ecosystem a little bit more, get a little bit more, more goods and services out of it. But even that can't last too much longer. And in a way we're doing it. You know, we're trying to squeeze as much out of it as possible, which is when the economic crisis hits, you don't hear so much talk about conservation anymore. And there's a lot of pressure then to relax environmental standards, to make the environment more business friendly. That's what you see happening. But even doing all that, we still can't have the growth rates that we had in the 50s and 60s, when in a typical year you could have economic growth of 6 or 7%, like China has today. We can't get that much growth anymore. So the problem then is that goods and services can't increase as fast as interest does. There's less and less means to pay back these debts. So what happens is that wealth polarizes very quickly. Those who, like, if Kevin comes to me, he's like, yeah, you know, I don't want a loan now because I don't really see any good investment opportunities. So I'm not going to be able to hire people either. So all of these people who need money, then they're going to essentially have to convert their assets into money, which is what we saw happen during the housing bubble, and their future earnings into money, pledge their income into the future, which is also what we see happening. Almost everybody's in debt now, unless you're wealthy, you're in debt. Graduate from college in debt, an average of $20,000 in debt, and you never, ever pay it off. It just shifts from one thing to another, and some people are living their entire lives as slaves to debt. It's kind of peonage, just like the serfs. You know, they, in exchange for land, which they needed to live, they had to give whatever half the harvest to the lord. And now, in exchange for money, which we need to live, we have to give half our productivity to the owners of money. Everything we buy has a secret tax. Even if you're buying a chair, most of that price is the financing costs and the capital equipment the factory had to services fast enough. And that's the crisis we're facing today. Would renewed economic growth solve the crisis? Temporarily, it would. If we can convert more of the earth into money, yeah, it would postpone it in a few years. But what we really need is a system that doesn't demand the endless conversion of nature into money. And that means we need a system that's not based on interest-bearing debt. So, this is one of the pillars of my book. It's not all about interest-bearing debt. There are other characteristics of our money system that need to change. But this is one of the important ones. So, one of the ideas I play with in this book is what happens if money, instead of having interest in getting more and more valuable, what if it decayed? What if it had the opposite interest? Last time I spoke somewhere, maybe the time before, someone they had like some kind of big kind of food bank kind of operation, and one day they got this shipment of like all these potatoes, like bags and bags of potatoes, and they quickly put out the word to everybody. They said, "We'll pay you to take these potatoes because they were going to go bad." So they basically gave away potatoes. It didn't do them any good to keep the potatoes, because you don't need a certain number of potatoes before they go bad, right? If I have bushels and bushels of potatoes here, I'm not going to keep them for myself. I'm going to want to get rid of them. I would be happy, in fact, to give you an interest-free loan of a 10-pound bag of potatoes, because maybe in a year I'll need potatoes. And I'd be happy to get a 10-pound bag. I don't need to say you have to give me 12 pounds or 20 pounds in a year, because if I keep them, they're going to go bad. So what would happen if money were like that too? If we had a money system where if I had more money than I needed, and if I kept it, it would just go bad. It would decay, just like everything else on this planet. Then I would treat money the same way as I treat potatoes. On a deep level, one of the problems with our money system is that we have money which doesn't decay, but only grows forever. But we have that linked to a world that does decay. We have exponential money linked to a cyclical world where things are born, they live, they decay, they die, and return to life. But money just grows and grows and grows. And so we've created a system where everything attached to money has to grow too, where the money realm has to grow and grow and grow and keep pace with the growth of money. But what happens? What would happen if money had the opposite characteristic, if it decayed? So that's one of the ideas that I play with in this book. And it's really, I mean, this is something that kindergartners should be able to understand. It's like, I have more than I need right now, so I will let you use it. That's what a zero interest loan is. People don't do that today because they can keep it and it'll grow. But if I keep it and it declines at 5% interest, then it would be to my advantage to give you an interest-bearing loan. So it aligns the spirit of a gift with financial incentive. Today, those things are opposite. Today, money is the opposite. It's the enemy of wanting to give to the world. Does that mean that we have to always live in this opposition? Always fight against money, fight against self-interest in order to serve the interests of others? Or can we change self-interest so that it aligns with the interests of others? Remember, that's what money's supposed to do. It's supposed to be society saying, thank you for doing the things that contribute to the benefit of us all. That's what money's supposed to do. So one reverse interest. Reversing interest has other important effects. So I want you all to pretend right now that you are the president of the world. Again, you are the boss. You can make decisions on behalf of the entire planet. And now here come the aliens. Okay, ETs land on your lawn, and they say, "Mr. President or Miss President, we'd like to make you an offer. You know, if you run this planet sustainably, you get a gross world product of, say, $20 trillion a year. Well, we'll make you a better deal than that. We'll give you $1 quadrillion for the whole planet. We'll buy it off you right now, $1 trillion. And then, yeah, you know, we'll liquidate it. We plan to remove the Earth's core and for the iron, and we'll destroy the planet. You'll be rich. Mr. President, Ms. President, do you accept this offer? How many people would accept this offer? What's wrong with you guys? Don't you understand that the interest on $5 trillion is way more than $20 trillion a year? It's to your financial advantage to accept the offer. Why won't you do it? You guys are irrational. Actually, the sad thing is that we are doing it. We are cashing in the Earth, and we're driven to do it by interest. We don't make a conscious decision to do that. But we make a billion little decisions that add up to the same thing. Say you own a forest. Okay, now you're not president of the Earth anymore. Now you just own a forest. And you could clear cut it and pave it over and build a Walmart there for $10 million. Okay? Or $10 million right now, making the offer. It's my wallet. Or log it sustainably in perpetuity and make $100,000 a year. What should you do? Well, the interest on $10 million is $200,000 a year, and logging it sustainably is only $100,000 a year. So maybe you personally won't cash in, but maybe you don't have a choice. Maybe it's your corporation, and you say, you know, we believe in sustainability. We're not going to maximize our profits. We're going to make $100,000 instead of $200,000. But then the corporate bear comes and says, oh, this company is undervalued because it's generating income of $100,000 for this asset, and it could generate income of $200,000. So the corporate bear leverages that differential, basically takes out a loan, buys the company, liquidates the forest, uses part of that money to pay back the bank, and keeps part for himself. And to prevent that from happening, you have to raise the value of your stock by maximizing your cash flow and cutting down that forest. It's called market discipline. And it's built into the money system. Okay? Whether you're a nice guy or not. Okay, now, though, imagine again you're the president of the world, but now money has bears negative interest. Now the alien's offer is ridiculous, or your forest. Now it's much better to have $100,000 a year in perpetuity than to have an asset that would decay. So negative interest reverses what they call discounting of future cash flows. It negates the way of thinking where we value the present over the future and destroy the Earth for future generations. Okay, so I'm just giving you a taste of kind of the technical details of this book. And there's a lot more along those lines. If that's the kind of thing you're interested in, there's about a good solid third of the book that's about that kind of stuff. Now I want to expand to get some of the bigger picture. Because money doesn't exist in isolation from the other institutions of our culture. It's not like we can just change the money system and everything will be fine. The money system is part keeps us trapped in these stories. The story of the self, up until today, has been, well, it wasn't this for primitive hunter-gatherers even, okay? But increasingly, up until today, the story of the self, it answers the question, who are you? What does it mean to exist? It says that you are a separate being, separate from other beings, in a world that's outside of yourself. That's not part of you. And maybe even your body is part of you. Maybe you're just this mode of consciousness, or this soul that's encased in flesh but separate from the world. And everybody else is like that too. And therefore, what's in your interest isn't necessarily in somebody else's interest. In fact, the more that you can control for yourself, the better off you are relative to your competitors out there. Because everybody else is your competitor, because we're in this outside, objective universe. More for me is less for you, by definition, because we're separate. That's the self that we're trapped in, increasingly, and that Descartes articulated. You're a bubble of psychology. You're a consciousness inside flesh. Religion, science, they all pretty much agree on this. They formulate it in different ways, but they all pretty much agree. And even if intellectually now we're beginning to reject that we're all separate beings, we're beginning to believe that something in you is in me, and that we're not really separate, and that what happens to any being on the planet actually is happening to me too. We're starting to realize that, but we're still trapped in many ways of thinking and trapped by many institutions in the old way of being and separation. But anytime, like, you say, well, like, there's lots of spiritual teachings that sound really good, but they're really coming from separation, such as, you are not your body. You are something separate, you are the spiritual. Well, no wonder we treat our bodies as not sacred. And if matter and spirit are two separate things, no wonder we treat matter as not sacred. It's just a bunch of stuff. And we step away from the world and think that the spiritual person is somebody who doesn't have too much to do with the world, doesn't have too much to do with the flesh, certainly not the marketplace. It's kind of non-involvement. A concern with higher things. Higher things. Well, what's so great about higher? Away from the earth, separate from the dirt. Cleanliness is next to godliness, or the obsession with purity, purification. Some spiritual paths are all about purification, being less fleshly. Okay, all of this, separation. And we're overcoming your biology, honing your willpower, dominating the flesh of the spirit, controlling your desire, not succumbing to desire, not giving in to pleasure. Okay? All of these things are part of this war against self, which mirrors the human war against nature. This is the war against your own nature. Externally, then, we have the story of the people, which says, it answers the question, what's humanity here on Earth for? What are we as a species? And it says, well, we're different from other animals. We are superior, and we are eventually going to dominate nature completely and become masters of nature. We're going to conquer nature. Back in the old days, we didn't really have much technology to do that, or much understanding. We had myth and superstition, but today we understand a lot more. We have technology. We're coming to dominate more and more parts of nature. Next is nanotechnology and genetic engineering, virtual reality, and soon we're going to complete this conquest. We're going to go into space, we're going to have synthetic food, we're going to conquer all disease, immortality, etc., etc., etc. That's the story of the people. That goes back to the days of agriculture, when we began to domesticate the world and turn other species towards our purposes. And it's reaching its peak today. In fact, it's a little bit past its peak. It was much easier to believe in the 50s that we were going to conquer space, conquer the atom, conquer this, conquer that. Everybody believed in it far. It was a great thing. one time, my dad was telling me, he's a kind of a liberal, you know, very anti-nuclear powerful. And talking back in the early days of atomic power, it was called, that they were saying power would be too cheap to meter. The atom would give us such a source of inexhaustible power that we won't even have to meter it. You just have a hookup fee, all the power you want for free. And I was like, haha, you didn't believe that, did you? What did you think, Dad? He said, oh, I thought power would be too cheap to meter. Like, everybody believed it. But we don't believe it anymore. We don't really believe that we're going to have this magical future that's being prepared by the scientists right now that will be unveiled to us, like the Jetsons with our robot servants. We don't believe in that. That story of domination has fallen apart because really it hasn't been working very well for a long time. We haven't conquered any new disease since 1973. The age of leisure never happened. Leisure peaked in 1973 also. You can say that our civilization peaked in 1973, actually. Since then, we've gotten sicker, gotten busier, and the quality of life has gone down overall. And I'm speaking in a somewhat culture-centric